you touched upon the reputation, and the reason why I just wanted to ask that question is because I guess reputation is built over time, right? So obviously it's not a short answer to why Frontline has a great reputation, and also maybe investors value the stock a bit more compared to others, but maybe it's easier to just explain the sort of investor or investment philosophy that Frontline tries to give, right? Because you touched upon it earlier in our conversation that Frontline has a specific philosophy that should be tailored for the investors on their behalf, right?
Absolutely. And the shipping companies, listed shipping companies, have, they have a various degree of reputation, or, you know, it's not always, to an outside investor, it's not always transparent. The business model is not always transparent. And, it tends to be, if you go on Wall Street and say you're representing a tanker owner, the first question the investor will ask, well, where are you screwing me? Pardon my French. And where are your hidden fees? So that's been a challenge to the tanker industry, and kind of basically made some investors hesitant to go into the companies. The thing is that for all the companies where we share the same big shareholder, transparency is really important, and it's basically I was thinking about that, and this is something that's rarely communicated well, but if you look at the common kind of red thread, which is probably a Norwegian expression, the common theme amongst the companies that where we share the same kind of major shareholder is actually as follows. And this is from an old presentation that was given many, many years back. And it's basically, it's keep it simple and focused, lean and efficient management teams, define where we are in this cycle, consolidation and economy of scale works, build credibility with customers, investors, and financiers, think and act like an investor. And this is all the management in the various companies' guidelines. So this is kind of, this is the DNA of Frontline, Golden Ocean, Flex LNG, Avance, SFL Corp. So, and the investors seem to appreciate that. So, at Frontline, we're blessed with relatively high liquidity in our stock. We have a brand name on the street. When an investor or a trader in the equity markets read in somewhere that this is going to benefit the tanker market, he puts FRO into his Bloomberg terminal because they know about Frontline, right? If you look at what's happened to one of my good colleagues, Øystein Kalleklev on Flex, look at the development in liquidity in that share over the last 6-7 months. It's just insane. From being a US listed company with very few shares traded, now the volume in the US is larger than in Oslo at times. So it's, or maybe even higher, I haven't looked lately. And it's basically to build credibility with your investors. And I think it's also very important for a tanker owner, and this obviously goes for Frontline as well, is that when you have a dominant shareholder, he will from time to time move into a position to buy assets when the listed companies can't, basically due to their financial situation. I think this is a good example from Golden Ocean. At some point then, this dominant shareholder, he does it not for purely for his own profit. He does it because he thinks that will benefit the listed vehicle down the line. So when you look at Golden Ocean, which last year kind of bought out, I believe it was 18 ships from our main shareholders' private company, it was done at a fair market price. Very transparent transaction. No hidden fees, no nothing. It was basically a fair market price, which even some analysts said it was on the cheap side. And you rarely see that in the world of the listed tax bonus. So this is kind of the key to how we build credibility with investors. Kind of the efficiency and low cost is always a theme on forefront line and our kind of the other companies in the sphere. But not, if you look at OpEx, for instance, kind of we share the same technical management platform. So the platform that manages the 75, 76 ships Frontline owns also manages the ships that Golden Ocean and Flex and Avance runs. And this gives through true synergies. So basically, we have a huge knowledge base to pull on with a relatively small organization. The technical management itself per ship is outsourced, but you have what you call fleet managers that are in-house, and they're overseeing the work that the technical managers are doing, and also then benchmarking the work they're doing. And it's not like we're going to save costs for any price, but by doing that, we at least have a mark-to-market on our cost, because we have different technical managers running the ships, and they're overseen by the fleet managers. So you'll find on OPEX that, Frontline is outperforming most of our peers by 10 to 20%. So that's not where the big kind of savings is. But if you look at on G&A, since we're a small management team, we don't have a stock of, kind of the amount of people running the fleet, it would be surprised many how a few kind of heads we are actually. So small focused management teams, which gives really manageable G&A costs. And then by building credibility with investors, but also financiers, we do access favorable terms on finance. So, and that's where the biggest kind of hit comes, or the biggest boost comes to Frontline, is our very low financial cost. The fact that a ship owner can place finance below 200 basis points for long-term financing of a vessel, for tanker, non-sustainable, I might say, it is pretty incredible. And this gives us a huge advantage and makes, this is why Frontline has what we like to say the lowest cash break-even levels, kind of, as far as we can understand, amongst our peers. And it also gives or puts Frontline in a position to, when the market turns, very, very quickly return equity to our shareholders. And I think we'll at the end, we're coming to the end here. And I think this is probably one of the most important parts for Frontline and for investors in Frontline, is that when you invest in Frontline, you're not only buying a stock kind of per se, you are that, but you're also investing together with our major shareholder. You're basically partaking in his bet. And he is just as interested as the normal investor on return on equity, dividends, and so basically you're joining him in a trade. And kind of when we get into position to pay out dividends, and we paid out $6.2 billion in dividends over the years. And we're going to continue to do so when we have the opportunity to do so. And it's so you as an investor, you should feel safe that you're joining an investment with probably one of the most scrutinizing investors, on the planet, as far as I can understand, and I know. So that's kind of, and the other thing as well is that if you're interested in no volatility, a safe haven, and a steady kind of returning stock, low risk and so forth, and low beta, low volatility, whatnot, then you shouldn't really, Frontline should probably not be your core investment. But this is just by nature, kind of the proposition what we offer investors is more or less direct investment into an extremely cyclical industry, being the tech market. So that's our proposition to the investor, and we're going to pay you, you know, back for making that investment. But of course, you know, since we're exposed to one of the most volatile markets in the world, the investment will be volatile too, but hopefully extremely rewarding. And it has been in the past.
That's a perfect ending, Lars. It was so much fun having you on. So thank you so much for taking the time.